Welcome to Fireside Gaming. I'm Billum, and we're continuing our retro game journey with a look at Mega Man Xtreme 2 for the Game Boy Color. I've been covering the Mega Man X series quite a bit on this channel, and that includes a review of the first Mega Man Xtreme game. I'll toss a link to it in the corner, but before you check it out, I've gotta make a quick amendment here. I did a dumb and didn't read the manual for Mega Man Xtreme before playing it. Because of that, I didn't know that you could dash by pressing down and jump at the same time. I really should've, since that's the same way you slide in classic Mega Man games, but the mistake is on me. As such, I may have been a little too hard on the first Mega Man Xtreme game, but I'm still confident in my final opinion of it. I just wanted to clear that up before we move forward with Mega Man Xtreme 2. Now that I've taken care of that, let's talk about what players can expect from this game. Just like with the first Mega Man Xtreme game, Xtreme 2 is set in between the main Series X games. In this case, it falls in between Mega Man X3 and Mega Man X4. However, the games didn't release in this order. Mega Man Xtreme 2 came out in July of 2001. That's worth pointing out as Mega Man X4 hit shelves in the August of 97 and Mega Man X5 released nearly a year before Xtreme 2 in November 2000. Because of this, there are some interesting choices made in terms of the story and gameplay here. Among this is the inclusion of Iris, a character that doesn't show up until X4, as well as Zero's gameplay. We'll get to the story later, so for now, let's just stick to the gameplay. Mega Man Xtreme 2 comes split in two parts. These are the X Mission and Zero Mission modes. Basically, the player goes through and fights four Mavericks from the past three games before moving forward to the final level and bosses. The thing that's worth noting here is that X and Zero don't fight the same enemies. Instead, they split up a total of eight Mavericks and levels between them. That means that players have to go through both modes if they want to see all of what the game has to offer. Actually, they have to go through three modes to do that. If you watched my review of the first Mega Man Xtreme, you'll remember that I mentioned Normal, Hard, and Extreme modes. Normal and Hard are just the story split in two parts, with Extreme mode being an optional one that players can skip as it doesn't add anything new to the game. Unfortunately, Mega Man Xtreme 2 doesn't follow this trend. Instead, it forces players to go through Extreme mode to see the true ending of the game. That's right, this game requires the player to play it twice just to see the end. That's a load of bollocks, and I almost didn't do it for this review. Luckily, that second playthrough doesn't have to take too long. That's because players are able to freely switch between X and Zero while playing. A simple press of the select button switches between the two characters. They've also each got their own health bars, which makes difficult boss battles a thing of the past. Even if it doesn't do a dang thing about this game's love for instant death traps hiding off-screen. It's also worth pointing out that X and Zero don't share weapon gets in this mode. That means that whatever character beats a boss gets that weapon. For my Extreme mode run, I blasted through it with Zero. See, he plays like his X4/X5 counterpart, rather than how he does in X3. That's a welcome design choice, but one that leaves him much more powerful than X in my opinion. Unfortunately, this also screwed me over as well. See, there were a couple of armor upgrades that I couldn't get for X because of this. Namely the head and the arm armor. That's because Zero's fire attack doesn't work on this piece of wood like X's does. Oh, it'll hit it, but it won't destroy it. Due to that, I just had to progress without completing X's armor, which feels like committing a sin in a Mega Man X game. To be fair, players really don't need all the armor in the game to kick in the teeth of anything that comes in their way. While the game does start off hard, it quickly becomes trivial to take down enemies. That's due to the game including a parts crafting system. Players can make parts and equip them to X and Zero to make them more powerful. There are basic parts that either can equip, as well as parts specific to them. This can give players better healing, reduce special weapon cost, lower damage, as well as more powerful attacks. While players can only equip a certain amount of parts to each character, it quickly gets out of hand. For example, with reduced special energy, you can kill just about any boss in the game of Zero just by using his Zero Final and Zero Dash abilities. I also equipped X with all of his power boost and watched as a single normal shot did as much damage as a fully charged one. The parts system is interesting, but it really does break the game. Either way, I did play through Extreme mode for the true ending, and I hated it. The sheer idea of forcing the player to run through the game a complete second time for one extra level and boss fight annoys me to no end. Just let me play through the game from start to finish out of the gate, Capcom. Alright, we've talked about the gameplay, now let's tackle the story. Spoilers incoming. Mega Man Xtreme 2 focuses on the erasure phenomenon. This is an incident taking place on Laga's Island, where Reploids are becoming hollow and ceasing to function. Zero and X set off to the Reploid Research Lavatory. Sorry, laboratory. Don't blame me, even the game makes this mistake. Or is it foreshadowing? Once they get here, they run into Gareth, the loyal guardian of Bracana, who is behind the Soul Racer incident. Sort of. Assisting X and Zero during their mission is Iris, a member of the Reploid Force that is working with the Maverick Hunters. Iris doesn't play a major role in the story, and really only serves to show that her and Zero knew each other before the events of X4, but we're not gonna cover that for this video. After defeating the 8 Mavericks guarding the Reploid Research Laboratory, the players are able to challenge Bracana and Gareth. If you play as X, you take down Bracana. Zero players will have to do battle with Gareth instead. It's also revealed at this time that the two were stealing the souls of Reploids to increase their own power. When playing through the X and Zero missions, the game ends here with the player having saved the day. Though, Iris will mention that it feels like they didn't get to the bottom of the Laga's Island mystery. This is where Extreme Mode comes into play. After players do all of what I just mentioned again, and at a higher difficulty, mind you, they can take on the true final boss of the game. Sigma. Yup, freaking Sigma rears his ugly head once again. Turns out he's the one that pushed Bracana into the Solar Racer research and is to blame for the game's events. This is another case of Sigma getting shoved into a story that he didn't need to be a part of. I accept him returning from game to game, but it doesn't have to be every single one. Of the Mega Man X games I've reviewed, he is the final boss of all 5 of them. If it was up to me, out of the games I've touched so far, he'd only be the big bad of X and X3. That would give him much more weight as a villain, but Capcom just can't help but cram him into every Mega Man X game. So X and Zero have to duke it out in one last battle against Sigma. Or two last battles, actually. The first is just his X2 form again, but the second is actually a whole new battle just for this game. It's kind of a puzzle battle that's a bit annoying, but the ability to switch between X and Zero at a moment's notice is used to great effect here. It's a welcome change after so many battles of the same bosses over and over again to get to this point. After beating Sigma, players get the true ending where the Solar Racer incident comes to an end, Reploids get their souls back, and X and Zero return to the Maverick Hunter base. Mega Man X2 is an okay game, but it's not one I can recommend for the casual X enjoyer. If I'm being honest, I'm torn on Mega Man Xtreme 2. The game takes a lot of what worked in Xtreme and builds on it for a better game. Heck, there's even a boss rush mode that lets players fight the bosses from the first Xtreme game. That's a cool bonus that I can appreciate. Unfortunately, the game comes with its own slew of problems. For one, there's no longer a way to set a dedicated dash button. That's a gripe for me, as Xtreme included this feature. I also can't stand that the game forces the player to run through it twice. It's almost 3 times even, since they have to watch all the cutscenes in both X and Zero's playthroughs, and then again for Xtreme mode. But it also does a lot right. There's no denying the improved gameplay mechanics, as well as the wonderful music and sprite art. But another counter to that is the heavy reliance on instant death traps. In addition to this, the only way to buy this game on modern consoles is on the 3DS eShop. Also, let's just take a second to laugh at the official eShop description referring to X and Zero as Mavericks. Just like with the first Xtreme game, this would have been much better as a bonus unlockable in the Mega Man X Legacy collections. I also do have to mention what I consider to be the best way to play this game. If you go the emulation route, you can find save files online that already have Xtreme mode unlocked. Grab one of those to play through Xtreme mode by itself. It's a much better experience, and one I can actually get behind. You can also buy the game on the eShop first to clear your conscience before emulating. That's all I have to say for Mega Man Xtreme 2. Thank you for watching, and feel free to like, comment, and subscribe if you enjoy what I'm doing here. You can also hit me up on Twitter at @Billum256. And as always, take it easy.